Well, good evening, everyone. Good to see you here tonight. Take a songbook. We're going to start by singing together. Come on in and find a place. Then turn with us in your songbook to 437, Since the Savior Found Me, number 437. Let's all stand together to sing. Brother Bob will lead us.
Since the Savior found me, pardon all my sin. I have had the joy and living hope within. Gone is all the shame and sorrow of the past. There underneath the precious blood of Christ at last. I'm saved, saved, saved. I'm happy on the way. Saved, saved, saved. I love Him more each day. Saved, saved, saved. I know He's mighty jar. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by His power. Since the Savior found me, all to Him I owe. For His precious blood has washed them white as snow. Now no condemnation, happy as can be. I'm glad that Jesus justifies and sets me free. Saved, 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 I'm happy on the way. Saved, 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 I love Him more each day. Saved, 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 I know He's mighty jar. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by His power. Since the Savior found me, I have perfect rest. Of joy and happiness, leaning on my Savior, looking for that day when He shall come to catch His waiting bride away. I'm saved, 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 I'm happy all the way. Saved, 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 I love Him more in day. Saved, 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 I know His mighty jar. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by His power.
Amen. Great singing tonight. And you must be saved to come to church on Friday night. And amen. Good to see you here this evening. And we had a good day today. Took a trip up to the zoo this morning and looked around and saw some of God's creation. Had a nice lunch together and got back home and had a fast afternoon and a good meal this evening. And had brownies and ice cream and whipped cream and Hershey syrup and wow, it was good. And there's no leftovers when we have that to eat, brother, let me tell you. And being good Baptist, we cleaned it up. Amen. But we're ready for a good service tonight. Had a great start last night, and looking forward to what the Lord has for us this evening. We're going to pray. We're going to sing our chorus that we sing each night, so you can get that on the back of your bulletin. And then we're going to turn it over to Brother Inman for his presentation and his preaching tonight. All right, let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank You for this evening. Thank You, Lord, for another opportunity for us to be together tonight. And thank You, Lord, for the wonderful service we enjoyed last night together and for decisions that were made. And You met with us, God, and You spoke to our hearts. And we bow before You now this evening, and we ask You to meet with us once again. These folks have made the effort to be here on a Friday night when I'm sure there's other things that tried to catch their attention and tried to lure them in that direction. But, Lord, they were determined to be here tonight. And so, Lord, I pray that our hearts would be open to what You'd want to say to us tonight. Bless Brother Inman. Bless Brother Cobb. Use them tonight, Lord, to give us Your word and to be used by the Holy Spirit to influence us for the cause of the gospel and the cause of Jesus Christ. We love You. We're thankful that we're safe tonight. Bless our service, please. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
All right, let's sing that theme song. It's on the back of your bulletin. If you received a bulletin, right there on the back. How will they hear? How will they know? We'll sing that through twice, all right?
How will they hear? How will they know? How will they ever find the truth if we don't go? How can we fear? God's love to show. Jesus desires every child his love to know.
One more time.
How will they hear? How will they know? How will they ever find the truth if we don't go? How can we fear God's love to show? Jesus desires every child his love to know.
All right. Well, we're glad to have the Inman family with us. They are in Thailand. They've been there 7 years. He'll fill you in about what they've been doing and what they believe the Lord will have them do when they return to the country. But Brother Inman, you come, please, if you would, and you take the next, let's see, it's 20 till almost, so you go to about 7:15, and we'll be good, okay? Thank you, my friend.
All right. Thank everyone here at the church for inviting us.
I think so.
Yeah. Y'all hear me? Move this up a little bit. My name's Chad Inman, and my wife, Sarah, in the back there. We've been married just a little over 10 years, and I was late to the game getting to Bible college. I didn't get to Bible college until I was 34, really surrendered to give my life to God at that point. And being a missionary, I thought was kind of the last thing I'd ever do. When I went off to Bible college, I'll tell you a little bit more about that. But Lord redirected me, and we've been in Thailand for just a little over 7.5 years. We came back in December and started deputation in January. And we were very actively involved in starting two different churches. And the video is going to basically take a snapshot of what's been done over there. The second church is unique in the fact that it's half Thai people and half Burmese people. And in Burma, they have about five main groups, different tribes, I guess you could say. And the tribe or group of people that comes to our church is called the Karen people. And you'll see a little bit about that. So, sir, if you would be so kind as to run the video. Thank you.
In 2008, the Lord brought my wife and I to the country of Thailand. We were called to join a team of missionaries with the goal of reaching Thailand with the gospel. From the very start, we were consumed with soul winning and with building a church. From powerful community meetings and Christmas programs held in public schools throughout the area, the Lord blessed. There were many salvations. Truck routes such as these were started throughout the area. Hundreds were brought to the Savior. Each year the church grew and prospered under the mighty hand of God. In 2011, the Lord began his plan to relocate us by sending a flood. During the 2 months that we were unable to live in our homes, we lived in a city 3 hours south called Hua Hin. It was at this time the Lord gave us a burden to reach this city for Him. The time was right, and the church planted in Bangkok was handed over to a Thai pastor. The work in Hua Hin began in a single storefront rental. At first, we had to find different ways to bring the people in, since taxis and trucks were not available. But praise the Lord, the people still came. We started an exciting children's program and soon rented an additional building. God's work continued to grow. Our care and ministry truly began because of Lek. James, one of his friends, became burdened by Lek's premature death. And he and I began to go soul winning throughout the area to various groups of caring people. Many of these dear people trusted Christ and started coming to church. They desired to know God, to learn, and to grow. But few could understand English or Thai. And even fewer had a copy of God's Word in their own tongue. As a result, the Karen Sunday School was started. It has grown both in numbers and in spirit. With converts bringing converts to Christ. Men such as these, Karen, Burmese, and Thai, have become faithful servants. They have become excited soul winners, and the next step is for them to go out and start their own churches, reaching even more of their own people. The desire of our hearts is to get back to Thailand, to help these men and women to continue the mighty work that God is so evidently doing in a nation open to the truth. Won't you join us? And my goal, as well as the other families that I work with, there's five families that we work very closely together there, and several Thai and Burmese people. Our hope is to start several churches. In fact, if each family were to take a national and start a church, we would have, you know, five or six more churches there, and would just be putting a small dent and the number of temples, Buddhist temples, in Thailand. And it seems like every hill or every new, you go around the corner and you look up on the hill, the high groves, and there you see a temple. Just like the Bible says, don't put the false idols on the temple up on the hills. And you see that all over Thailand. And of course, Buddhism is a religion that's driven. It's fear-driven. And preacher mentioned that last night. It's a very mysterious religion where you want to try to appease the right gods or the right spirits. And all over Thailand, people live in smaller houses, but out in front of their house, you will see a little miniature house, and they call that a spirit house. And the whole idea of that little miniature house out in front of their normal big house is that's the house for the evil spirits to go into. And they set soda pop out in front of that house and hang flowers and sometimes put food out there to try to appeal to the bad spirits. It's a very superstitious way of thinking. When they get home, and obviously nobody's drank the soda, a lot of times they'll just pick it up and and drink it and put a new one out the next day. And so this has been going on for hundreds of years, over 400 years. These people and families and different generations have been doing this kind of thing because they've only had the King James Bible for 10 years, only for 10 years. When we were there in 2008, they just started mass distributing it 3 years before that. Or 2.5 years before that. And so there's so much room for the people to grow there. There's so much fertile ground there for people to learn of Jesus and to shed their Buddhist
like nature. I grew up as a young person, as a Catholic here in the United States. I was born into a Catholic, actually born in Cincinnati, adopted into a Catholic family. And so I know what it's like to be a Catholic. I learned more about being a Catholic after I was saved and in a Baptist church than I ever did being a Catholic. And, you know, I couldn't believe some of the falsities that took place in that religion. And Buddhism is very similar. You've got young people that grow up doing things that are Buddhist. You know, it's a special day. It's a special event. I'll do it because mom and dad have done it and Grammy and Grampy have done it. But it doesn't really mean much in their heart. And so when you tell them about Jesus and they understand that he's the true one living God that can save you and take you to heaven, a lot of people get very excited about that. I would say the majority listen. Many, many people get saved. And those that we've witnessed to and have resisted have come back, and you know, we've come across their path again and have gotten saved. Sometimes they just want to see our motive for being there. You know, why are we there? Why are these Americans over here in Thailand when they could be in America trying to learn our language, trying to follow our customs, trying to take care of people? What, you know, what are they doing? Are they making a profit off this? And so their curiosity is piqued. And so sometimes, you know, if we have a big day or invite somebody to church, sometimes they'll come and learn of Jesus. And so it's a special place. I would invite you all to come visit there. It's very unique in the fact that Britain or France has never taken it over. It's always been its own country. And the people there are different. The language is very, very unique. John 3:16 goes something like this. It says, Prawa prajao song rak lok mak jong dai song pratam prabhu ong dio kopra ong ti ban gut ma pu pu dai ti chua nai prabhu nan jap mai pina dami shi Whitney run. And every word has a different tone. It's either high, middle, low, falling, or rising. And the tones are the most important for those people. They're listening for the tone. I'm trying to get the letter right because I'm thinking American, and they're listening for the tone. And so we've come a long way in the language, but we have a long way to go. And my wife and I was telling one of the couples here, the Yoders, they asked some very good questions to me. Basically, the thought that I want to give you is that God planted our heart there. We feel like it's home. You know, things are different there, but we want to go back and spend the rest of our days there in Thailand. And reaching those people, we've already got 7.5 years invested. And one of the big answers to prayer, I was also asked this question, was what are some ways that God has really shown you that you know, you're supposed to be in Thailand, or you're supposed to come back and go on deputation, or whatever it is. Well, in Thailand, it's 12 hours time difference. They're 12 hours ahead. So I kid around with people and tell them I can tell the future. You just call me 8:00 at night. I'll tell you what's going on tomorrow. And with that, when I started making calls to set up meetings, I would have to start calling at 8:00 at night. And what I was doing over there didn't change. I mean, I was working full days, so I had to put on my happy face and start calling pastors. And I hadn't done this. In fact, I'd never done it before. And I was really kind of scared about it. And the first week, I believe it was, or close to it, I had called your pastor, Pastor Slabaugh, and within a day, he had sent an email inviting me to this conference. And that just doesn't happen that easy like that. In fact, it never happened like that again with anyone else. And I felt like the Lord was really just saying, you know what, Chad, we're going to take care of you. And we're going to be able to get you into some conferences. And you know, you don't even have to speak directly and say a lot or call, you know, 10, 20 times, there's going to be some people out there that are going to have you in open arms. And so, Pastor, I appreciate that, sir. That was a huge encouragement to me as far as making calls. And, Preacher, what time did you say I had till? 7:15. Okay, I want to make sure. And y'all have been so friendly. Thank you for the zoo. Thank you for the all the good cooking and the warm spirits here in this church. Your auditorium is really dazzling. It is really nice. I heard that there were some recent upgrades made, and it's a beautiful place and warm people. And it's fun to be here. It's great to go to churches like that. I already told you that I was brought into a Catholic family. When I was 16 years old, I was invited up to a youth activity up in just south of Cadillac, Michigan. It was in a little town called Tustin, Michigan. They have a Bible camp there. And the group that was hosting that camp was called Campus Life, Youth for Christ. And a friend of mine from high school invited me to that. And we did some downhill inner tubing. Have any of you all done that before? You go downhill. This was a big hill. It was up there by Bittersweet Ski Resort, I think was the name of it. And it was fun until you got about halfway down the hill. And then you're just trying to survive, you know. And one guy broke his leg that day. And that night they gave a presentation. And at the end of it all, they asked us if we knew for sure we're going to go to heaven. And with heads bowed, eyes closed, they went through the explanation of it all. And I raised my hand for salvation. I was 16, up there on a very cold winter night up in Michigan. And I was just excited. A couple of my friends were already saved. And then a couple of the guys that I was with had gotten saved with me. And I went behind the auditorium and talked to the youth pastor. And he questioned me a little bit and just, you know, wanted to make sure I understood. He said, "Chad, we need to get you a Bible." And that was about it for a while. I went back home, continued to go to the Catholic Church with my parents, was in public school, went off to a public university, got a business degree. And that's went to the same school my dad did over here at Indiana University. Bobby Knight was still there at that time. And I'm in Ohio now. I got to be careful what I say here. But in any case, I graduated from there and went to work for a large company called Unilever. There's several little companies within that company, Breyers, Ragu, Lever Brothers, which makes all kinds of soaps. And they do a lot of business at Walmart. A lot of their products are there. And I worked for them for a little over 12 years. And about year 9 into that, my father passed away, and my dad and I were close. We were really close. He taught me how to shoot guns. We would do all kinds of things together on the weekend, and it was a real shock for me because he had a heart attack. He was 64 years old. I was 29 years old. He used to take me to the Kmart parking lot when I was 14 years old and let me drive. And if there was snow on the ground, he'd let me do a donut in the parking lot. And my dad was cool. I mean, we had a lot of fun together. But that was a real big moment for me. I mean, I had trusted Christ as a teenager, but my dad was gone. And I just decided in my heart that God was going to be my dad. And I was just going to trust that the Lord knew what he was doing. And I was just, you know, God is my daddy now. And 4 years later, my mother passed away. And she was battling cancer. She had been battling it for about 6 years. And that was hard also. But the blessing that came out of that was right after Mom passed away, I was living in Northern California. And a friend of mine from work, he was my buyer. You know, I was in sales and marketing for Unilever, and he was my main buyer. He did most of my business. He said, "Chad, why don't you come spend Easter Sunday with my family?" And me and my brother get together, and he said, "I know it sounds kind of strange, but we have an Xbox competition, and it gets kind of serious, you know." And I'm thinking, wow, you know, 40-year-old men playing Xbox is kind of strange, you know. But so anyway, I called him up that Sunday morning, And he said, why don't you come up right now? He said, we're cooking breakfast. And he said, I just started going to this storefront church just right around the corner. It's a one-hour service. He's like, maybe you can come to that with me. And I did. And the preacher preached the gospel just as pure and clean as could be, just like when I heard it when I was 16 years old. Before we got into the church, my friend Tim tapped me in the arm. He said, Chad, now I want you to know it's kind of loud at this church. I'm like, okay. I'm thinking, do they play music or what is it? And it was a small church. It was probably half the size of these pews here. And I sat in the front row, and there's a giant speaker right in front of me. And he was preaching loud that morning. Small church, big speakers. And I raised my hand for salvation, not really remembering what I had done 16 years ago. It all kind of came back to me later on. But I got reassurance that morning, and this time I had a real good church to go to, and warm people that were encouraging. I thought the men on the front rows that wore the ties, I thought they were the owners. I thought, man, they're the only ones that are wearing the ties, and they're always greeting people at church. I thought, maybe they own the church. And no, they're just servants, you know, just like the men back here that do the things at this church. And started to grow in the Bible. The pastor there, he would talk about the Bible the way I would talk about football with my friends. And he got me involved in the nursing home ministry. I can remember the first sermon I preached there. A hundred so people, about 90 of them asleep, and one little hand in the back that went up at the end of the sermon. But in any case, it was a blessing to grow in the Lord, and I knew God was calling me to do more, but was resisting it. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:58, many of you may already have this in your brain, but therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. And one of the messages that I want to give you tonight is the fact that as a saved Christian, as a child of God, when you decide to do something for Him, big or small, I mean, it could be as small as filling your gas tank so you can get to church the next day. It could be as big as deciding to go soul winning for the first time. But whatever it is, God sees it, and He recognizes it. And the Bible is our lamp. You know, the Word of God is a light unto our path. But God is, you know, He's not looking to strike you down with lightning. In fact, He would probably prefer not to do that. And He'd much rather try to recognize the good things that you want to do for Him. And in my life, I was going to California Church there, Victory Baptist Church, on the north side of, east side of Oakland. And I felt like God was calling me to do more. But I didn't really want to. Since I got reassurance there, my job was getting better and better. I was making more and more money. With my mother's car that I basically inherited when she passed away, I had five cars. I love cars. And it's crazy because you can only drive one, you know. And I liked old cars, and I just kind of thought I, you know, was happy making a lot of money, getting a lot of accolades at work, but there was, I felt like God wanted me to do more, and it almost turned into a little bit of a battle between my successful boss, who was pushing me to climb that corporate ladder, and I was on some special mentorship program where I flew and did special meetings and things, and then there was my pastor, and he wasn't really pushing me to do anything. He was just being my friend, giving me the Bible, and one morning, my pastor asked me, he said, Chad, have you ever thought about going to Bible college? And it was early. I usually get to church early Sunday mornings and help them put some signs out and organize songbooks and things, and just real quick as I could, just came back and said, oh, no, pastor, not me. I'd be a good layman, and, you know, make sure I tithe, and, you know, I think God wants me right here. And he didn't think much of it, but I sat about in the middle here of church, and I couldn't understand a word Pastor was saying. All I could think about was, wow, Chad, you just totally lied to the pastor. Totally lied to him. He said, you want to go to Bible college? And you said, no. And you know God's calling you to Bible college. And I struggled with that. I drove home that afternoon, and I lived 30 minutes from the church in a little subdivision. And as soon as I pulled into that subdivision, there was this big open house sign. And followed that around. It was a twisty-streeted neighborhood. I'm so sorry. and the house right behind my house was being sold. And if I scared them, I'm sorry. My son's the same, so don't worry about it. But in any case, I walked into that open house, and the realtor told me that the house was already sold. And I'm thinking, wow, Lord, you know, if you want me to hang up this job and go to Bible college, you know, I guess you can do it. And finally, I made the decision to sell the house. The realtor I was working with, she got saved. I was able to give her the gospel. And she was excited that I was going to try to sell the house and go to Bible college. My company didn't know what I was doing. I couldn't afford to pay for the house without working for the company, so I needed to sell it first and then tell them, you know, I'm gonna leave. And the house sold in 30 minutes. In fact, it sold so fast I didn't have a place to live. I wasn't going to college till January, and it sold like in October. And my neighbor had a little, I guess it was like a profit chamber in the back of his house. He had been renting it out to make some extra money. I didn't even know. But somebody had moved out, and he said, well, I've got an open slot for you. Why don't you just live next door to me? And I tried to pay him. After living there a month and a half, he wouldn't take it. And I can remember packing up and getting ready to go out to Indiana, to Hiles Anderson, to go to college. And I still had all my parents' things and all my dad's sporting equipment, and I didn't have time necessarily to get rid of all that stuff. So I had a very large U-Haul. It was one of the largest U-Haul setups that you can rent, at least at the time. I believe it was a 26-foot truck with like a 12-foot trailer, something like that. And I packed that thing up and was headed off to Indiana. Well, what I didn't tell you is that through all this, there were some trials. You know, I'm kind of giving you the easy version, but I had some difficulties giving up certain things in my life. I was really into music. I had a very large CD collection that I'd spent a lot of time and money on over my 20 years of being a music purchaser, and I knew that music didn't please God. I'd come home from Sunday church and kind of look over there. I wouldn't listen to it, but I knew it was there. I knew it was a problem. And I can remember putting all those CDs in a box and driving to my friend's apartment complex, because the first time I tried to throw them away, I set them out at the curb on Monday, but the trash guy didn't come till Wednesday. And somewhere along the road, I think it was Tuesday night, I decided to bring them back in the house and felt miserable about that. In fact, ashamed to even say it up here, but I went to a friend's apartment complex where they had a big dumpster. I knew the trash guy was coming the next day. I can remember picking up that box and chucking it up real high into that dumpster. And what a great feeling it was. And so... My first point is that God recognizes all the good things that you do. Secondly, he rewards you. The Bible is very clear that we shall receive rewards, either here or up in heaven. And the Bible says, for everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be open. Over there in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, we read specifically about rewards being given in heaven. And so just know that no matter how difficult it might be to take a step out for the Lord, He sees you, He recognizes you, and He rewards you. And I don't really have a necessarily good Bible verse for this next one, but there's no regrets in taking those steps. Throwing those CDs away was, I don't regret that at all. I'm so happy. I'm so happy. I don't have to look over in the corner and think, oh, you know, that one's not going to please God. Deciding to go to Bible college, I'm thrilled that I had the opportunity to do that. And sometimes God will give you direction to take a step forward for Him. And the fact that God is even calling you to take a step like that is a reward in itself. It's almost like it's a door opening with the word reward under it. And then when you go through, you might even get rewarded more, either here on earth or up in heaven. And so as I'm driving that big U-Haul truck all the way out to Indiana, I come to the foothills of Reno, Nevada, Lake Tahoe, and it's snowing like crazy. And the police officer has a checkpoint there, and he says, sir, you're not going to be able to drive this U-Haul tonight. It's snowing too hard. You're going to need to get some chains and give it another try tomorrow. And I did that and got about three-quarters up the next day. I had snow chains on the U-Haul now. And the traffic comes to a dead stop. And there's no traffic coming on this side of the highway, and everyone in my two lanes, it's like a parking lot. In fact, some people, they got out of their cars. They start having snowball fights. They turn their cars off. And the whole time I'm wondering, wow, why is the traffic stopped? You know, I know it was a big snowstorm. And turned on the radio, and sure enough, man, that devil, he put some music on, same as those CDs. And I sat there just like, wow, I can't believe I'm even listening to this. I am going off to Bible college. And the news came on a short time later, and a large U-Haul with a large trailer had gone over the cliff on the other side of the hill. And same setup as mine. And I knew God wasn't trying to kill me. I mean, the Bible says don't look for signs, but I felt like the Holy Spirit was convicting me and saying, you know what, Chad, you really need to get rid of this. And get victory on this. And of course, you know, I feel like I have. And I feel like today I'm working with a lot of Thai people that are struggling with vices of their own. Maybe it's idols that they have purchased for many years in their house that were passed on from generation to generation that they spent a lot of time and money on. And they're trying to dump that the same way that I was throwing away those CDs. And God will use your steps of growth to help someone else. And he'll recognize those steps. He'll reward them. You're not going to have any regrets. And God will represent you along the way. He'll encourage you. The same way I was encouraged when Pastor just kind of fired through that email and said, congratulations, you're invited to the 2016 Missions Conference. I'm sure you can think of moments in your life where God represents or just backs up what you're doing for Him. When I left the company, my vice president, according to his testimony, he used to be a Catholic and now he's a Christian. And he took me out to eat with all my coworkers, there are about 12 of us. And he said, you know, I just want to announce to everybody today that Chad's leaving the company. He's leaving on good terms, and he's going to go serve God. He's going to go to Bible college and serve God. And he said, I want everyone here to know that I'm a little bit jealous. He said, I wish I could do something like that. And let me tell you, not all those people were Christians. I know because I tried to witness to a lot of them, and I didn't get very far. But God represents you when you decide to take a step for Him. And the greatest thing that I could tell you tonight is that God is real. Everything that you do for him or decide to do for him, that's eternal. That goes forever. And way beyond what a job can offer you in pay or what a friend can promise you in the future, God's rewards are real. And your steps for him, maybe helping somebody to come to church or putting a little money towards Faith Promise. I don't want to steal preacher's thunder, but all those things, that lasts forever. You'll look up in heaven and say, well, I don't have any regrets about that. And you'll see how God recognized you, rewarded you, represented you, and see that you had the faith to follow him because you knew it was real. And those are the kind of exciting things that we have seen in Thailand from people who have grown in the Lord, people who have stepped out in faith and just done something nice for somebody, not expecting anything in return, people who decide not to work on Sundays because they want to go to church, and they could make a lot more money working on Sundays. We have one lady, she works for free, so she can go to church on Sunday. She gives her boss a free day of work. And I just want to encourage you tonight and let you know that if God is calling you in a certain way, maybe it's something small, maybe it's something big, but you'll never regret it. And it's eternal. And Pastor, I thank you so much, sir, for allowing us to come this week. It's been a blessing. Thank you, sir.
Well, I enjoyed that. Enjoyed that. Great, great testimony. Love to hear that. All right, listen carefully now. Tomorrow is the parade in the morning. And it will, good chance you're going to go and you're going to get wet. Okay, now we're praying it won't, but just be prepared for that. But we've got 6,000 John and Romans to get passed out. And a ton of candy and such. So if you're going to be, and if you're working on the float for the parade, Bob wants you here at the wonderful hour of 5 a.m., okay? You have to be down. You're going to leave to go get in line by 8 or 8:30 to get in line with the float. All of us who are going to walk along and pass out the John and Romans and the candy and such, we're going to leave here. We'll leave the church probably around 8. Meet here at 8:30 sharp, okay? Brother Don, we'll be ready to load up and head out by, I'd say, what do you think, Bob? 8:45 or so, something like that, to get down. Same as last year. You'll drop us off near that shopping center. We'll walk down to the UDF, and we'll wait for the float to come up, and we'll meet them there, okay? And then we'll go through that. Just ask the Lord to give us some a window of dry there that we can get the gospel out during that time. That'd be great, and we look forward to that. So 8:30 if you're going to go along. If you're helping on the float, 5 a.m., okay? And because you still got some work to do on that to get it ready, and there's just no other time to do that. Now, we do need, did the chairs and tables get in? Okay. Need some fellas right after the service tonight. We've got the rack with the folding chairs on it that's on the side of the fellowship hall here. And you have to get the chairs, some of the chairs off of that rack before you can roll it in. Otherwise, it just tears the sidewalk up. So if you could do that and get the tables back into the fellowship hall, we'll start getting those ready to be set up for the dinner tomorrow night. Tomorrow night, 5 o'clock for the international dinner. And that's always a great time. And, of course, the service follows right after that over here in the auditorium. And Saturday night's always a special night, the Missions Conference, and you don't want to miss that, okay? So we'll have a great time together tomorrow morning with the parade and then tomorrow night at the international dinner, okay? Good to see some of the RU folks here, and glad they made it in. And we want to recognize any other guests we have with us tonight. Anybody else here tonight? You brought a guest with you. It's your first time here. Is there anybody like that? Right here? Okay. Tell us who you are and where you're from. Okay, good, good. You've been here before. You've been here Friday night? Yeah, that's right. I remember. I met you. Good. Good to have you back. All right, Jeanette, who's with you? Tina. Good to see you tonight, Tina. Glad you're here. All right, good. Anyone else? Wonderful. Okay. Take a songbook. We'll sing together, all right? Take a hymn book. Go over to number 243. I am resolved no longer to linger. 243. Go ahead and stand together and we'll sing it. Brother Bob will lead us.
I am resolved no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, these have allured my sight. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to go to the Savior, leaving my sin and strife. He is the true one, he is the just one, he hath the words of life. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee.
Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you.
I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee.
Let's sing that last all together. I am resolved to enter the kingdom, leaving the paths of sin. Let's sing that last together.
I am resolved to enter the kingdom, leaving the paths of sin. Friends may oppose me, foes may beset me, still will I enter in. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee.
Amen. Great singing. You can be seated. Ushers will come and we'll receive our offering tonight, our offering each night. It'll go to our missionaries and for a love offering to them for taking time out of their schedule and coming to be with us. And we've been blessed by them spiritually, and we want them to be blessed by us materially. And so I ask the Lord what he'd have you to do, and let's give generously to them tonight, all right? Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the privilege that is ours to listen to your servants this week and to be able to talk with them and allow them to influence our lives. And we thank you for them. Thank you for the blessing they are to us and the encouragement. And I pray, God, that you'll bless our giving to them, that we can be a blessing to them. And Lord, possibly some things they've been asking you for and desiring that you provide for them, and you'll provide for those needs through us this week. And Lord, that would be a great, great blessing for us. And so, Lord, use the offering tonight. Bless the gift and the giver, please. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, looking forward to hearing Brother Cobb again tonight. Chad and Sarah are going to come and sing for us, I believe. And right after they're done, Brother Cobb will come and preach for us this evening. All right?
Mekarum don tuk chow. Me hang peace at tika, chop chai way la condia, sa wang ha prat bida.
Do we son I prakam pi, rap witi chai pratao tuk thin, dayin siang meta praong, trat my glua. Yuning
we la con dia sung om nem jai ka chu fang pra cha we la con dia sung om ka pra om tu cha
don nun ka a ti tan la tu kung pra chow song kong we la kon dio song of doi pra ong he's with me all the time wherever I may go each moment of the day he's always there I know but I need that special time when I bow before his throne just to read his word and talk with my Lord alone my quiet time alone gives me power to obey. My quiet time alone with God each day. I talk to him in prayer. Every day he meets me there. My quiet time alone with God. My quiet time alone with God.
Praise the Lord. That was pretty. Didn't understand everything, but well, I certainly enjoyed that testimony. I love to hear how God has worked in people's hearts, amen. And so I also enjoyed that dinner tonight. That was really good. It was too good, really. But we're going to try to share the Word of God with you tonight. Do you have your little card that you got in your bulletin? If you don't have one of these, I have two of them. I'll give someone one of mine. But this is your faith promise card. If you're a member of the church or attend here regularly and want to get involved in helping to send missionaries, this is what it's all about. If you're a member of some other church, you need to be giving your offerings there and serving the Lord. But we thank God for what this church is doing to send the message of Christ around the world. If I need it, they need it over there too. Amen. Last night I mentioned the theme of the conference, How Shall They Hear? That's from Romans chapter 14 and chapter 10 and verse 14. How shall they hear without a preacher? We need preachers of the gospel that can go to other places. And the gospel is what people need. The gospel is good news. Okay, what is it that they need to hear and understand? We mentioned last night, they need to understand that they are in danger of perishing and that God does not want them to perish. God is not willing that any should perish. That's good news. It's bad news that they're perishing, but it's good news that God cared and he sent his son to die. The second thing I want to mention, and this isn't my message, this is extra, but the second thing I want to mention tonight that they need to know is that Jesus died for them. The Bible says, the Apostle Paul said that Christ died for our sins. That's the gospel. And he not only died, he rose again from the dead. Now, there is a certain doctrine, and I don't want to get going on this, but it's quite popular today, and it's been around for several hundred years, just kind of comes and goes. But this doctrine says that God only wants to save a few. That he doesn't really want to save everybody. He just wants to get a few. And that Jesus only died for those who God has predestinated to save. He didn't, according to them, that he didn't die for everybody. Now, I don't know about you, but my Bible does not teach that. My Bible says that Christ died for our sins. And if I, as a missionary, go out and I'm preaching to a group of people, or if I'm talking to one person, I cannot honestly give him the gospel if I believe that and say, you know, Jesus died in your place. Well, what if he didn't? I wouldn't be telling the truth. But the Word of God says that Jesus tasted death for every man. I wonder what it tastes like. It's awful. It's bitter. Remember that cup he said, if this cup can pass from me, nevertheless thy will. I think that cup was our sin, and he drank it. He took our sin on himself, and then God poured out his wrath toward his son while he hung on that cross. My Antigua version of the Spanish Bible, I was reading it one day, and in Romans chapter 8, it says that God did not pardon his son. In English, it says God did not spare his son. But in Spanish, it said pardoned. I thought, why would Jesus need to be pardoned? Because he became guilty of all our sin. And when God saw him with all of our sin, he did not pardon him. He punished him. But that's why he pardons us. That's the good news. The Bible says in 1 John 2:2 that Jesus is the propitiation. That's a big word that means that he satisfies God. He's a propitiation for our sins, us Christians, but not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. So there is wonderful, wonderful news tonight that we have to tell everybody. You cannot find a person alive on this earth, but what you can walk up to them and say, Jesus loves you, and he died for your sins. He died in your place. He took what you deserve. Now, what are you going to do about it? You ought to love him. You ought to accept him. You ought to thank him. Amen. Well, that's the message we want to send around the world. And so pray about what you should do during this next year to make that happen. Are you glad that you have a Bible? Are you glad that the gospel has come to you? Well, then you ought to want to take it to someone who has never heard before. Well, let's turn in our Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 16. I might entitle this message, An Offering for Others. General William Booth, who was the founder of the Salvation Army, and years ago they used to preach the gospel, and today I think it's more just a help organization, it seems like. But when they had their annual meeting one year, William Booth was so ill and feeble and nearing death, he was not able to attend the meeting, and he sent a telegram to all the people that were gathered, and it had one word on it: others. I believe this church is dedicated to others. I can see that. I don't see that everywhere I go. But you have a group that is trying to be a blessing to those who are addicted. I think I need to join. I'm addicted to that ice cream and brownies with the chocolate syrup. I gave in to that addiction tonight. But really, a lot of folks need help, amen? And you're not going to probably fill your church with people that you are helping. Maybe maybe you will help them and they may go on their way other places. You're not doing it. You're doing it for them, not for you. That's what I mean. You go to the prisons. Some of those men you're preaching to and women, they may never get out of there and they'll probably never come to church. Maybe one or two will, and praise God for that. But you're not doing it to fill your church for yourself. You're doing it because you love others. Because Christ loved you, amen? And so you go to the nursing home. How many of those people in the nursing home are going to come to church and join the church and start serving? Probably not. Probably not. But why do you go? Because you care about others. And so that's what we're going to be thinking about tonight in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, beginning in verse 1. The Apostle Paul says, "Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God hath prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. And when I come, whomsoever ye shall approve by your letters, them will I send to bring your liberality or your offering unto Jerusalem. And if it be meet that I go also, they shall go with me." Let's pray. Father in heaven, help us tonight, we pray, Lord, to understand how you love others and how we ought to love others and how that you want to reach out to them and how you want to use us to get the gospel to them. Now, Lord, we would rather not talk about money, but money is necessary to send preachers. You've even said in your word, "How shall they preach except they be sent?" And Lord, we know that it must be done. And Lord, we thank you that you give us joy. It's not a punishment, it's a blessing to be able to give to you so that you could send out those who go with the gospel. Now, Lord, have your way in the service tonight. We'll give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. So the Apostle Paul is organizing this offering, this special offering, and he's telling all these different churches around Asia Minor and over in Greece, to the Corinthians, and he's saying, now look, the saints back in Jerusalem are suffering, and they're suffering persecution, and they're in a bad way, and we need to help them. And so all these churches are getting involved. And so it was coming time for them to complete what they had promised. He had talked to them a year before. They'd made a promise. And so he wants to arrive there and he wants the offering to be ready. You know how it is. If you're going to give a large amount of money, it may be hard to come up with. So he's got a plan. He said, on the first day of the week, you lay it by you in store. You save it up so that there won't be any collections when I come. So you will have it. So it'll be ready. And then we can take it to those that need it. Now, we read in the book of Acts why this was necessary. In chapter 8, in verse 1, it says, "Now Saul," this is the Pharisee Saul, later he was converted to Christ and he became the Apostle Paul. But at this time it says, "Saul was consenting unto his death." That's Stephen. Saul helped to murder the deacon, Stephen, the saint of God, And it says, "And at that time there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem, and they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria except the apostles." So this apostle, this Saul of Tarsus, who became later Paul the apostle, he's just causing all kinds of trouble for God's people, and they're being scattered. In chapter 11, in verse 19 of the book of Acts, "Now they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none but unto the Jews only." Then in verse 27 through 30, "And in those days came prophets from Jerusalem unto Antioch, and there stood up one of them by them named Agabus, and signified by the Spirit that there should be a great dearth throughout all the world, which came to pass in the days of Claudius Caesar. Then the disciples, every man according to his ability, determined to send relief unto the brethren which dwelt in Judea, which also they did, and sent it to the elders by the hands of Barnabas and Saul." Many times this Paul was, even after he was saved, he was still called Saul. And later on he became known more as Paul. I think that's a Latin name. So anyhow, this offering was needed for those people who had been displaced, those people and their families who had suffered, to go out and spread the gospel around and preach. And I don't believe this was the offering, talking about the offering for the church itself. Now, some people interpret it that way, but in its context, I think it's talking about an offering for people somewhere else. And, you know, God doesn't tell us a lot in the New Testament about just exactly how we have to do everything and how we need to finance the needs. He does tell us that the elders or the pastors ought to be taken care of financially, and some ought to be given more honor, those that teach the Word of God. So he tells us that we should do it, but God doesn't have to tell us everything. We have sense enough to know how to do a lot of things. And so, you know, in those days, they didn't have church buildings. As far as I know, they probably met in homes, and they didn't have electricity. They didn't have a light bill to pay. They didn't have automobiles to. They maybe had to keep their donkeys fed. But you know, he's telling them about this special offering and how to do this. And so, you know, this I believe is really a missionary offering. It's for people somewhere else. It's for people who have been preaching the gospel, for people who have been scattered and they've gone out and they've suffered persecution. Now, it's not exactly the same as what we're doing today, but I think the principle is the same. We are asking God's people to make a commitment, maybe for a year, to help send missionaries. And maybe the church will have a conference next year if Jesus does not return first. And then you could maybe consider renewing your faith promise. We call it faith promise. It's just a name we give it, because by faith we are promising to give this amount. And if you think about it for a whole year, that might be a little scary. But if you do it every week, you can handle that. And especially if you're doing and giving what God wants you to give, and you're trusting Him to provide it. And he certainly can do that and will do that. So this is what we're talking about, this offering for others. And the first thing I see in 1 Corinthians 16 and verse 1, I see that faith promise involves pastoral leadership. The Apostle Paul was not exactly a pastor. He was a missionary, but he influenced these churches. Many of them he had personally helped to build in the first place. He had gone and preached the gospel, and the church sprang up and grew. And so he had a certain amount of, with we could say, authority or influence. And so he, as a leader, is organizing this thing. And thank God for pastors and church leaders who will plan and organize to send out missionaries and to get them out there. It takes a certain amount of leadership and administration. You know, a church member may say, well, you know, it's really too bad that those people in Thailand have never heard of Jesus. You know, it's just too bad. And you know, someone ought to go. And a pastor and the leaders in the church will say, okay, it is sad that they're without Christ. Let's send a missionary to them. Okay, let's plan how we're going to do this. And just like the Apostle Paul is saying, now, on the first day of the week, every week, you lay aside a certain portion, and then after a year, you will have your faith promise to give. Now, thank God for pastors who believe in missions. I know some that don't. Oh, they may say they do, but like we say, put your money where your mouth is, amen. When it really comes down to that, that's a pretty good way to describe it. You know, we need to do more because there's more need. Every year, there's millions of more people on this earth that are needing the gospel. And thank God there's some missionaries going. We need thousands more, literally thousands of more missionaries to go. But thank God there's some that are going. And thank God we can help get them there. But you know, when there's so few churches that will really get involved, it makes it difficult. Brother Clint drove, I think, from Michigan to Texas just a few days ago. And then he drove back to Ohio. And now he's going from here to Alaska. Can you imagine that? And he's been doing this for a while. And he's praying, Lord, I'd like to get to the field before I wear out another set of tires. Amen. But you know, it's good for a missionary to go around and meet God's people and get God's people praying for them. But instead of taking 3 or 4 years, if we could give more so that the church could help them more, so that they wouldn't have to spend so long. What could a man do in 3 years on the field dedicated to learning the language? Oh, you could get a long way. So the extra time that our missionaries are running around the country trying to get enough support, if they could get to the field and spend that time learning the language and learning the culture and learning to communicate to people, they would be 2 or 3 years ahead. So anyhow, I met a young man many years ago. I was Hopkinsville, Kentucky. Anybody heard of Hopkinsville, Kentucky? There's two things it's famous for, and I forgot one of them. But Jefferson Davis was from Hopkinsville, Kentucky. I don't know. Do you know who Jefferson Davis was? Well, he was a president. Not the president of my country, but the president of the Confederate. My great-grandfather fought in that war, and I think he fought on the right side, but bless their heart, there's a lot of people died on both sides. It was the most terrible thing in our history that I can ever imagine. But I went to Hopkinsville, and I met a young man that was starting a church. He just had a storefront building, like Brother Chad described, and I said, I'd like to come and present our work. At that time, we were working in Mexico. And he said, no, brother, he said, we're not going to have any missionaries until the church grows enough so that when they can support me as their pastor, then we will start supporting missionaries. I tried very gently and very sweetly to say, "Brother, I believe God would bless you and help you if you would start supporting missionaries right now. Don't wait." Not because I'm a missionary, because I believe that's the thing to do. Well, of course, missionaries don't tell pastors what they ought to do. They might try, but they don't always listen. I don't know how long that young man stayed there, but there's no, that church is not there. But another man went there by the name of Ken Shaver, and do you all know Ken Shaver? He started a church, and he started supporting missionaries right away, and God has blessed that church, and it's grown, and they're on a just right close to Fort Campbell, and they get soldiers in there, and then they send them out, and they're coming and going, but that church is seeing God's blessing. But missions is an important part of that church. So thank God for pastoral authority. And then another thing I see here is that faith promise involves personal involvement. He says in verse 2, 1 Corinthians 16:2, "Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God hath prospered him." So it involves personal involvement. You know, giving to God is personal and it's voluntary. You do not have to give anything to the church or to God. You can be saved. It doesn't cost you a penny. Jesus paid it all. His blood was enough to save the entire world. He doesn't need our money. And so you could join the church. You could live now I'm not saying you ought to, but you could. I don't think the pastor's going to charge you to come in those doors and sit on these chairs. He's not going to say, "Well, you didn't give your offering this week. We don't want you next week." No, that's never going to happen. It's personal and it's voluntary. Now, the Holy Spirit may want to talk to you about it, and you better listen to Him. But what we do for God, what we give, is between us and God. That's the way it is. And Jesus said, "Don't even let your left hand know what your right hand is doing." Someone said, "Yeah, the left hand is ashamed of what the right hand is doing, so he doesn't let him know." No, but I mean, it's none of anybody's business what you're doing. It's between you and God. And so in 2 Corinthians, now this is still talking about the same offering. God took two chapters, well, actually part of chapter 16, and then you go over to 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and 9, and he's talking about this offering again. And there he says, "Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver." So we are free in Christ. And nobody's going to say, "Okay, if you don't give a certain amount, you're a poor Christian, you're not a good Christian, or we don't want you." Never is going to happen in this church, or any church that I know of, I hope. But the thing is, it's personal, and it requires personal involvement. And this is what I like about faith promise, because we're giving to missions above our tithes and offerings, what we normally give for the church. We're given extra to send missionaries. So if more comes in, we can help more missionaries. We don't stop helping the church. Of course we don't. You wouldn't not feed your own children so you could give food to somebody else, you're going to take care of your own family, and you're going to help somebody else at the same time. But some churches will just take a little bit out of their general fund, the money that comes for the church. They'll give a little bit, maybe 10%, maybe even a little more, and they say, okay, this is what we're giving to missions. A lot of churches do that. And I'm not saying that's wrong, but I think the faith promise giving is so much better. Because, you see, okay, I'm going to give 10% of my income to the church, let's say. And I think, boy, that's really great. That's just a good place to start. If you stop there, I think you're stopping too soon. But so I'm going to give my 10% no matter what. If the church doesn't send anything to missions, I'm still giving my 10%. You see, so I'm not really giving to missions. Maybe my church is giving, but I don't have that personal involvement. But with faith promise, I'm giving to missions, and then when those letters come back, I'm going to want to read them. I'm going to want to know what's happening in Thailand and in the island of Borneo. And I'm going to want to know what's happening over there in China or in Siberia. My heart is in it. Jesus said, where your money is, there will your heart be also. And so it's a personal thing. So how should I arrive at the conclusion of how much I should promise? Paul talked to these people before, and apparently they all decided individually what they should do. How did they come to that conclusion? Well, should I ask myself? Should I just look at my finances and say, well, I think I can afford this much? That's what the world would say would be a wise thing to do. But you know, that doesn't require a lot of faith. But should I go to my accountant? Now, he's an expert in finances. He may not be a Christian. He may not know much about missions or the things of God. Should I just say, well, what do you think I ought to give? He's probably going to say, are you crazy? Why would you give anything? I mean, you need that money. Why don't you invest it? Give it to me and I'll invest it for you. Amen. But who should we ask about how much we should give? Anybody have an idea? God. What a novel idea. What? Why? Whoever thought of that? Why don't we ask God? Why don't I get alone with God and say, Lord, what do you want me to give? What do you want me to promise? And if God seems to lay on our heart a certain amount, it may be more than what we think we can afford. Probably will be. And we might argue with God and say, oh, no, Lord, I can't give that much. And just keep praying about it. But if God really wants you to, that's where the faith comes in that he's going to provide it. And he certainly can. I wish that I'd have started 45 or 46 years ago writing down every time God blesses me financially after I got involved in faith promise missionary giving. I didn't do that. And I forgot more than I can imagine. But just every week, just about God is providing and God is blessing. And some of you could give some wonderful testimonies as well. But we just need to trust God. It requires a purposing in our heart. It requires a putting aside. Paul said, lay it aside. In other words, just don't. You've got to protect it. And it also is a matter of proving our love. In 2 Corinthians 8:8, Paul said, I speak not by commandment. It's not a commandment, it's an opportunity. He said, but by occasion of the forwardness of others. Other people have said what they're going to do, but he said, and to prove the sincerity of your love. You know, we invest in what we love and what we believe in, and this is an opportunity. Then, the third thing about faith promise, it includes a prospering. In verse 2, the latter part of the verse, it says that he should lay by him in store as God hath prospered him. Okay, so it requires a prospering. God must provide, or we cannot give. I remember when I first started, when I first learned about faith promise missionary giving, and I promised, at that time, I promised $20 a month, $5 a week. That doesn't sound like much, but I was working, I was going to Bible college, driving about 50 miles one way to get to Bible college. I would get to work maybe 1 or 2 in the afternoon, and I'm working in a barber shop trying to make a living. This is back in the early 70s. Any of you remember what men were doing with their hair back then? Some of you had some then, amen? They were letting it grow long. They were boycotting they were persecuting us barbers, and it was rough. And so, of course, I got to pay the bill at the Bible college, and I've got to put gas in the car, but God took care of me. I would set my tips aside. A 25-cent tip then was pretty good, and probably about 1 out of every 5 guys would give a tip. Not everybody did, and I hope you tip your barber, amen? But she might be your wife. I don't know. But anyhow, God provided. Even under those circumstances, God provided so I could give my offering to missions. And it's been that way ever since. So God is able to provide. He can prosper us. I believe He wants to. In 1 John chapter 5 and verse 14, it says, "And this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He heareth us." So, we are asking not for ourselves, not so that we can have something else, but we're asking God for this offering so that we can give it to send missionaries. And brethren, that's God's will, that people go out with the gospel. I know that. I have no doubt about that. So I know I'm asking according to God's will. And I know He's going to hear me. And how more could we be in God's will than asking God for the means to send missionaries out? So it involves a prospering. Can God do that? Has God done anything for you financially lately? I'm sure He has. You need to give Him glory for it. But it's a blessing when God gives you something and you know it comes from God. Now, it may come from the hand of a friend, but you know it came from God. Amen? And so, that's it. You can't give it if God doesn't give it to you. So, faith promise also involves protecting the offering, a protection. He says in verse 2 that he should lay it by him in store. I kind of studied out that word. I read it in my Spanish Bible, and I think I looked it up in Greek, and I'm not a Greek expert, but the idea seemed to be to treasure it up or to store it, to protect it, to not just to be careless with it, but to guard it. And so we need to protect it. We need to protect it from ourselves, amen? In other words, when God gives it to us, or we decide, okay, this is what I'm going to give. Now, the way I do it, every month, I do it monthly. You probably should do it weekly, but the way my finances are, I do it, most of my mission giving is monthly. Some is weekly, but most of it is monthly. And so I just go ahead and give it, write out those checks, and give my offering, and then trust God that He's going to return it to me so I can pay my bills, so I can put gas in the car, and so on. So now that's the way I do it. But, you know, I just had to put some shocks on, or struts or whatever, on my old car. Mary said she was not going to go on another trip in that car. It's a little bit old, and it's a nice car, but you go over those bumps and it just starts going up and down, and she tends to get car sick anyhow. So that was quite an expense, you know, but God provided. But I might be tempted to say, well, this month, instead of giving my offering to missions, I'll just take that money, and those struts are expensive. They're not like the old shocks, you know, $20 a piece or something used to be in the old day. Now they're a little more than that. But, you know, there's that temptation. Or maybe hunting season. I'm not a hunter. I probably should be, but I'm not. But I might say, boy, you know, I really would like a new rifle with a nice scope. Or maybe people spend thousands of dollars to kill deer that they don't even eat. Sometimes there at BBTI, we get deer given to us that people, they might cut the head of it off. They want the rack, but they don't want the meat. Well, we're glad to have it, amen. But you know, there's a guy came from Alaska, if you can believe this, down to Texas to kill a couple of white-tailed deer, and he paid $5,000 for each one that he killed. And he could have hunted moose or elk or bear or whatever up there, but he spent all that money just to, I mean, you know, there's that temptation that we may have to use our faith promise for ourselves, or it may be a legitimate need. So we have to protect it. And then Paul said, now those who are going to carry this money, you appoint them. You be careful who you choose. And if it's necessary, Barnabas and I will go with them, and we're going to have to be careful with this offering. It doesn't belong to us. It's given to God, and it's given for the purpose of the poor saints at Jerusalem. And so there needs to be a protection. Well, we know what God wants done. The Bible says, how then shall they call on Him whom they have not heard or have not believed? And how shall they believe on Him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And then listen to the next part. That's where you and I come in. And how shall they preach except they be sent? We've got to send them. You don't send them out with a pat on the back and say, God bless you. Just no, there's expenses involved. And it's very expensive. I mean, you're going to go, Clint and Sailor are going to go up into the island of Borneo. They're probably going to have to get in wherever they go by plane. And it's going to be very, or helicopter maybe. It's very, very, very expensive. But those people need to hear, amen? So there's no doubt that there's a need. And you and I have been blessed with this opportunity to be involved. And I hope that you'll take it seriously. I hope that you will take your card and there's amounts on the back. Maybe it doesn't go far enough. Who knows? But pray about it. That's all we're asking that you do, is just pray about it, think about it, and just do what the Lord seems to impress your heart to do, and then do it. Amen? But you know, like I mentioned, if you're not a Christian, or if you're not part of the church, this isn't really for you, but God does have something for you. He has a gift for you. He wants to give you eternal life. I asked a lady in Mexico one time, I said, talked to her about the Lord and about eternal life, and I said, would you like to have eternal life? And she said, who wouldn't? Amen? I mean, we all want to go to heaven. We don't want to go to hell. And so Jesus has made a way. He has gone to the cross. He took our sins on himself like a sacrificial animal that they killed in the Old Testament. God poured out our sins on his Son and poured out his wrath. And Jesus died what we deserve. Remember, he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He was forsaken. He was abandoned by God because he bore our sins. That's what happens to a person in hell. They're abandoned there. But Jesus was abandoned for us. He said, I thirst. People in hell are begging for water. But Jesus took that. He suffered and died and paid the price. Now all you do is believe that he did it for you. Just believe. And then it'd be nice to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for doing that for me, and I accept it. I receive you. I trust you. I want you as my Savior. Wow. God wants, that's what God wants to do for you if you've never done that. Brother Chad gave his testimony. It took him a while to understand what it meant. But maybe you have never done that. You haven't trusted Christ. Would you do it tonight? Pastor's going to come in a minute. We're going to have an invitation. And it's going to be an opportunity for you to respond. And somebody can take the Bible and talk with you and explain it a little better. Maybe have a question or two. You can answer the question, pray with you. You don't have to say anything or do anything. We just want to be a help to you if that's your need tonight. Let's all stand as we pray. Maybe just before I pray, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I wonder if there's anyone that would say, Brother Rex, I wanna have this eternal life. I want to be forgiven. I want to accept Christ who went to the cross in my place. Would you just pray for me? I won't call your name or anything like that, but would you just raise your hand and say, Brother Rex, pray for me that God will help me to make this decision. Is there anyone? Okay, let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity to be here tonight. Lord, we are so blessed to have a Bible in our hands, the Word of God. Lord, when there's so many thousands of people groups out there that don't have a Bible, they don't have a missionary, they have no hope, and Lord, we pray for laborers to get out there to where they are. We pray, Lord, that you would raise them up, even from this church, Lord, and send them out and help us to get them on their way. And Lord, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you would please, and we're going to pray again in just a moment. We'll have our invitation. But I wonder tonight if the Lord has spoken to your heart just about involvement in the faith promise. And let me help you with something. He mentioned it tonight, as God has prospered you. And you think about Well, I just don't have it to give. How much is the cable bill a month? How often do I stop at the convenience store and get something? Can I add that up over a month's time? How much is that? We have things in our life that we put the money on, and I think it'll be pretty sad when we stand before God one day and say, God, I didn't have anything to give towards missions, and God begins to bring these things up to us that we spent on us instead of others. Look, ask God to. That's why I think David said, Lord, you search my heart, because I won't do such a good job. I'll overlook some things. God, you search my heart. Will you ask God to search your heart tonight and really pray and ask him how he'd have you be involved? Maybe tonight he's asking you to be involved. Maybe you heard Brother Chad's testimony tonight and you listen. As you listen to that, you know that what he was struggling with there and when God was calling him. Maybe you're struggling with those same things. Maybe God's speaking to you about being a missionary. Maybe going to Bible college and getting some training, and you're like, come on, Lord, I'm 34 years old, or I'm 38 years old, or I'm 40 years old. Are you kind of wrestling with God? Are you making excuses? Are you surrendering to him? You'll never go wrong if you say yes to God. You'll never go wrong if you say yes to God. So whatever God's speaking to your heart about tonight, say yes to him. If you're here tonight and you've never received Christ as your Savior, you may have another opportunity to be saved. I don't know. But I know you'll never have a better opportunity than you have right now. And that is to receive Christ as your Savior. When others come to pray tonight, would you come? I'll meet you at the front. We'll have someone who's been trained take a Bible. They can show you how you can know you're on your way to heaven. But whatever it is that God's dealt with your heart about, you ought to respond to him tonight. Father, bless this invitation now. I pray you've spoken to people's hearts. I pray, God, that decisions will be made for you tonight and folks will be open to what you want to do in each one of our lives. God, thank you that you're a God who wants to be involved in our lives. You're not a God that's far off, but you're a God that's near. And so, Lord, have your way in every heart and life, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, our pianist's going to play. As she begins to play, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. The invitation's open for you to come.
That's right. Jesus, I surrender. All to him I freely give.
Amen.
I will ever
Amen.
Love and trust him. In his presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender. Make me Savior, wholly thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed. surrender all. Oh, to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power. Let Thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Father, thank You for this evening. Thank You, Lord, for the message from Your Word tonight. Thank You, Lord, that You did not leave us on our own when it came to giving to others and for the gospel to go to others, but You gave us Your plan. And Lord, I pray that You would increase our faith and that we would trust You and realize that when we get involved with Faith Promise Missions, that You get involved in our life, and that's the way we want it, God. And so, Lord, help us to depend upon You, and help this year for Bible Baptist Church to be the greatest year yet in our giving to get the gospel to the ends of the earth. Lord, thank You for each one that's made the way to the service here this evening. I pray Your blessing upon them as they go. And Lord, we're asking You to give us a great day tomorrow. I pray Your hand will be upon the John and Romans as they're distributed. Lord, may they find their way into the hearts of people. I pray for many to come to know Christ as their Savior as a result of what we do at that parade tomorrow. So, Father, be with us now. Give the missionaries particularly, Lord, a good night's rest. Lord, continue to have Your hand upon them. We love You. We thank You for what You're doing in our midst. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now, listen, are you folks? We're going to go to the second talk now. We're doing reverse order. Remember, 3-2-1 instead of 1-2-3. So you'll go to the second talk. We're going to need to clear the auditorium as soon as we can. So missionaries, if you go down to your places in the conference room, feel free, church members, go down there and see them. Our ladies, your group will meet. Tanya, just circle up in the back like you normally do, right back there. And that'll be the ladies' group. Men, you know where you go, to the basement. And I'm sorry. The kids need to be aware. They can be in another room, can't they? Can't they take the Bob Wallace's Sunday school room?
Sure.
Kids Club or Lindy, whatever. They'll go to the Bob Wallace's Sunday school class, first through third grade boys, right next door. You can go in that room. Or you can go to Mrs. Wallace's at the end. That's where the kids will go for Kids Club. And then... after that's done, we will get the, we'll come, where are you going to go for the first talk, Bob? Back in here?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll come back up here for first talk, and then we'll still have our fellowship, Lord willing, okay? Hey, can we get some guys that will make sure those chairs get carried in, enough of them off the cart so you can wheel the cart? That would be a blessing. Got some guys who will do that for us, okay? Thank you, James. Thank you, Brian. Okay, Brother Andy. All right. Good. Thank you guys for doing that. And that'll be great. Okay. God bless you. You are dismissed.